Most people are used to seeing waves break as they approach the coast, but at a few locations around the planet, there are special waves that break for miles and miles inland. They're called tidal bores, and in this video, we're going to explore the science behind why they happen. And at the end, we're going to hit the road and find one. And spoiler alert, we might try to surf it.
What the hell am I doing?
If you're enjoying these videos and want to support us to make more, check out our Advocate Apparel program at waterlust.com. We make environmentally responsible UV protective swimwear that supports marine species and ecosystems that need our help. Every product ships with fun and fascinating educational materials that we create with leading marine science educators. That way, when someone asks you about your whale shark leggings or sea turtle board shorts, you'll be prepared and empowered to share what you've learned with others and drive positive change. Thank you so much for the support. The ocean is filled with waves, little capillary waves that sailors look for when searching for puffs of wind, steep choppy waves that can turn a boating day into a wet and wild ride, and swells that travel long distances and sometimes break beautifully on reefs and coastlines to the delight of waiting surfers. While all of these waves have distinct characteristics, they also have one thing in common. They are disturbances in the surface of the water that are created by wind. But there's another type of ocean wave that affects us every day that has nothing to do with wind. It's called a tidal wave. To understand how tidal waves work, you first need to understand how the tides work. We made a video that takes a deep dive into the physics of the tides. And if you haven't seen it yet, pause now and watch it before moving on. We'll be referencing some of its concepts in this video, and seeing it first will make things easier to follow. We'll put a link to it in the description below. Tidal theory tells us that the gravitational fields created by nearby massive objects, like the moon and the sun, will produce a bulge of water on the sides of Earth closest and farthest away from them, and low points of water in between. As the Earth rotates, these watery high and low points stay in the same place relative to the sun and moon, creating daily, monthly, and yearly fluctuations in the ocean water levels that we call the tide. The movement of the watery high and low points around the planet is called a tidal wave, and it's similar to the ocean waves we've already mentioned, except it has a much longer wavelength. Quick note, people sometimes use the term tidal wave incorrectly to describe a tsunami, a huge rogue wave created by an earthquake, but they are not the same thing. As the name suggests, a tidal wave is a wave that is created by the tides. Because Earth's tidal wave has such a long wavelength and small amplitude, in most places you can't visually see it in the same way you can see an approaching ocean swell. But there are exceptions. In some parts of the world, the tidal wave approaches as a visibly breaking wave called a tidal bore. But why does this happen in some places and not others? To explain this, scientists model the coastline as a simple inclined plane. As the tidal wave passes, sea level rises and falls, and the position of the water's edge moves in and out. Most of the time, the speed at which this happens is very slow, because most coastlines are relatively steep, and the amplitude of the tidal wave is low. But if we were to increase the amplitude of the tidal wave while keeping the coast slope constant, the incoming water would travel faster and farther up the coast. Or, if the amplitude of the tidal wave were kept constant and the slope of the coast were reduced, the incoming water would also travel faster and farther up the coast. The key here is to identify two variables that can lead to incoming tides traveling farther distance inland in a short amount of time: high tidal amplitudes and low coastal slopes. In our video about the tides, we discussed why some parts of the world have higher tidal amplitudes than others, places like the Bay of Fundy, so we won't repeat those details here. Just keep in mind that some parts of the world have larger tidal amplitudes than others, and a high tidal amplitude is one of the two ingredients needed to create a tidal bore. The second ingredient is a gently sloping coastline. But where on Earth does that happen? The answer is rivers that flow into the sea. Some rivers have very steep slopes, and water flows down them vigorously driven by Earth's gravity, while others are gently sloped and water flows down them slower. As luck would have it, there are approximately 50 locations on Earth where large tidal ranges and gently sloping rivers result in the creation of a tidal bore. To visualize why this happens, we can use the metaphor of an airplane creating a sonic boom. If a plane is traveling slower than the speed of sound, then the sound waves it creates will run ahead of it, and no boom is created. Conversely, if the plane is traveling faster than the speed of sound, then the sound waves it creates will get left behind. But if the plane is traveling at exactly the speed of sound, around 343 meters per second, then the sound waves it creates travel along with it and build up over time into a large pressure wave we call a sonic boom. The key here is to understand that there are two different variables playing a role in the creation of a big pressure wave. The speed that the airplane flies through the air, which is a function of how big its engines are, and the speed that the sound waves the airplane creates move through the air, which is a property of the air itself. A tidal bore happens in a very similar way. Here, instead of the speed of an airplane moving through air, we consider the speed of incoming ocean water moving through river water, which again is controlled by the tidal amplitude and the slope of the coast. And instead of the speed of sound waves propagating through air, we consider the speed of shallow water waves propagating through water, which is a property of the water itself. And just as a plane can move slower, faster, or at the same speed as the sound wave it creates, the water from an incoming tide can travel slower, faster, or at the same speed as the water waves it creates. If the speed of incoming water, driven by the tide, is less than the speed of shallow water waves, then any waves that get created will propagate ahead of the water and dissipate. If the speed of the incoming water is faster than the speed of waves, then any waves that get created get left behind. But if the speed of the incoming water is equal to the propagation speed of waves, then any waves that get created stay with the incoming front, and a large wave can form. Whether or not a tidal bore is created and maintained is a delicate balance, and waves can form or disappear along the same stretch of river depending on how its slope changes. In a detailed study in 1928 of the tidal bore that forms in the Trent River in the United Kingdom, scientists showed how no wave is created early on in the river, where the slope is steepest, marked here between positions A and B, but that it does begin to form at position B when the river slope flattens out. The wave reaches its largest size by position C and then gets smaller and smaller as the slope of the river reduces farther upstream. Reading about these marvels of hydrodynamics is one thing, but for this video, we wanted to see one in person. The closest tidal bore to us happens in the Bay of Fundy, home to the largest tidal range in the world. If you want to understand why the tides are so big here, check out our video about the tides we mentioned before. We explained it in there. The bore we set out to find travels up the Petit Kodiak River from the northern end of the Bay of Fundy to the city of Moncton. The tides here are dominated by the principal semi-diurnal tidal constituent, meaning that the bore happens every 12 hours or so you can only see it once per day. We arrived in the early morning just before the bore reached Moncton, and like clockwork, we could see it and hear it approaching. Watching the bore cruise by, you can see the interplay between the phase speed of the waves and the speed of the front. In some sections, the waves begin to stack up and align with the front, but just as quickly, they become misaligned and dissipate as the front races ahead. It's incredibly dynamic, and the presence and shape of the waves changes constantly as the riverbank twists and turns. In this section, you can see the river getting more constricted. The waves slow down and get closer together, but eventually lose touch with the leading front and dissipate entirely as the front surges ahead. As we watched the footage after the bore passed, I couldn't help but start mind surfing the wave. It's just something surfers do. Even if it's only a 6-inch peeler, you can't help but wonder, could I ride that? And as luck would have it, I did have a board with me, so why not stay one more day and try to surf the bore? So that's what we did. The tidal wave associated with the M2 tidal constituent has a period of a little under 12 and a half hours. So when we woke the next morning, you'll notice the sun is a little bit higher in the sky than it was the day before. I put on my thickest wetsuit, grabbed some cameras, and headed out to the section of the river where we had seen a wave form the day before. At this stage, I should mention that surfing a tidal bore is very dangerous, especially in cold temperatures. I don't recommend anybody try this at home, and it is something that I will probably never do again, and I'll explain why later.
That was less than awesome. I am a chocolatey mess, but I was warned about that.
What the hell am I doing?
It is 8 o'clock in the morning and
it's freezing cold. It is, I think, below freezing. Can't feel my hands. And we've got about 9 minutes until the tidal bore arrives. These are the moments you start asking yourself, the hell are you doing here? The water here is really, really brown, so you can't see anything.
Let's see. It's pretty nerve-wracking doing this. It's kind of weird
knowing exactly when the wave is going to arrive. That's a very odd feeling compared to like surfing when you just go and it shows up whenever. And the other thing is that we only have one shot at this a day. Because it's late in the year and there's so little sunlight, we can't get two low tides in daylight. So if I fall or if I mess up, then that means we gotta wait 24 hours or a little more than 24 hours until the next attempt. So I'm a little bit nervous. I don't wanna fall, but I'm trying not to think too much about it. Just do it, just send it. I see it. I can start to see some of it coming around the bend. It's pretty intimidating. Oh yeah, it's on, it's happening.
I was able to ride the bore for a minute and a half before the waves dissipated and I was unable to keep up with the front. And it was awesome. But I also want to be real with you, it was also pretty scary. When the ride ends is the part of tidal bore surfing that I think is particularly dangerous. Because after the front passes, you suddenly find yourself in a river with very strong current flowing upstream in the opposite direction. If you've ever run rapids on a river, you know to always check out what is coming downstream before you put in. But with the tidal bore, the flow switches directions and it's incredibly disorienting. That, and climbing up muddy banks with quickly rising waters, is not easy. Despite being covered in so much mud that I needed a pressure washer to clean my gear, seeing and surfing a tidal bore in person was an amazing experience. It made me appreciate the delicate balance between a tidal wave's amplitude and coastal slope that is needed to create these unique waves, how powerful it is to observe science in action in the real world.